Thanks, everyone. So I want to start by rewinding the clock back to 2010. Gary Wolfe, the editor of Wired magazine, stood up on the TED stage in Cannes and started talking about this new fad he was observing among his tech enthusiast friends who were using new gadgets to quantify their mood, their physiological data, and even the number of nappies their children were going through. The notes for the talk described this as an intriguing new pastime, and in a related article published in the New York Times, Wolf went into a little bit more detail about how his friends and colleagues were using these devices to determine whether that daily coffee dose was having a positive or a negative effect on their productivity, and even the number of times that they had to clean up after their roommates' dishes. So Wolf acknowledged in his talk and in his article that he was talking about outliers, about geeks, the fringes of society. But if anything, looking back now, I think it shows the durability of this type of person. Because who here, if you yourself haven't used one of these apps or a device to quantify your mood, your training data, to count your calories, or something else, that you haven't, or at least don't know someone who has done it? So even though Wolf gave his talk less than 15 years ago, looking back now, I would say it's a little bit quaint. Looking around, I reckon there's at least half of you wearing some kind of wearable device. And if you count the smartphone in your pocket that's counting your steps, then the figure is closer to 100%. And this is reflected in the latest ownership statistics for a bunch of different countries. In the US, 40% of the population owns some kind of wearable device. In Germany, the figure is a little bit higher, 42%. In Sweden, 45%. In the UK, 53%. And here in Ireland, based on a survey that my research group has recently conducted, the figure is closer to 60%. Wearables are now being adopted as quickly as the mobile phone was in the early 2000s. And in 15-year time, maybe it will be just as popular as a smartphone. Maybe the two will merge together. But will it be for better or worse? Today, I'm going to talk to you about some of the challenges facing wearable technologies, some of the barriers that are in the way of them realizing their full potential, and some of the risks if that potential is realized a little bit too well. Most of this information has been taken from surveys that I and other researchers have undertaken among the general population in lots of different countries. I'm also going to talk a little bit about some of the meta research that my group is conducting at the moment and our efforts to set up a data donation platform and a data bank for wearable devices. Now, I started the talk back in 2010 talking about the quantified self movement, even if I didn't explicitly name it. That term, the quantified self, was coined by Gary Wolfe, who I've already mentioned, and his colleague Kevin Kelly. Like I said, they were editors at Wired magazine at the time, and their thesis essentially was that measurement underpins everything about modern society, economics, finance, property, and more. Except, they said, for the cozy confines of personal life. It hadn't quite gotten into that space yet. Now, it makes for a nice narrative, but the reality is that humans have been engaging in self-measurement for centuries. Take the example of the Italian physician Santorio Santorion, who at the turn of the 17th century constructed a set of giant scales which he used to weigh himself. So throughout the day, Santorio would weigh himself before and after meals and before and after going to the bathroom to see what kind of effect metabolism had on his weight. The difference today is one of scale. You strap on a smartwatch or a fitness tracker, and you can quantify your heart rate, the number of steps you're taking, the distance you travel, your respiratory rate, your blood oxygen saturation, whether you have a new cardiac arrhythmia. We are rewarded with so much more data, with so much less effort. But why? What's the point of all of this? This is where it starts to get a little bit controversial. Advocates of the quantified self movement would cite anecdotes of how they've used their fitness trackers or their smartwatches to diagnose their sleep apnea, their allergies, their migraines, or at least overcome them. Essentially, they discover some food or habit or tic that until that point had resisted the cures of mainstream medicine but yielded to their pattern-finding prowess with the aid of their fitness tracker. Again, it makes for a nice story, but is there any research to back that up? Well, with the exception of a few population-based studies, there's not a huge amount. But there is some really nice research that has leveraged wearables to conduct real-time surveillance of flu-like illness. This study, published by a team at Scripps, recruited 200,000 consenting Fitbit users. The users wore their devices between March 2016 and March 2018, and provided they met the study's threshold for device wearing, so provided they wore their device long enough, they were included in a model for predicting influenza-like illness outbreaks. And the researchers found that if the users had abnormal results in heart rate, sleep, and physical activity, that this aligned neatly with the prevalence of flu-like illness. So presented on screen are five different graphs. Essentially, the prevalence of flu-like illness in five different states: California, Texas, New York, Illinois, and Pennsylvania. The red line represents the traditional method used by the CDC to track flu. The trouble is with that red line is that it can only really be plotted around about 3 or 4 weeks after the fact. So it's not very good at giving hospitals and healthcare organizations the heads up that their floors are going to be crowded with an influx of patients. The green line represents the baseline prediction model. That's based on standard hospital reports and statistics. The blue line here with the 95% confidence intervals represents the data from wearable devices. It integrates measurements of heart rate, sleep, and physical activity. So because the blue line so closely matches the red line, think about what this means. Because it so closely matches that ground truth, this represents one of the first examples demonstrating how wearables could be used for disease outbreak prediction. This could be really important for responding quickly to health threats, obviously. Now, unfortunately, this research was conducted before the coronavirus pandemic. And we just didn't have the resources or the infrastructure to make the most of these findings. If only. Because if the research being conducted out of the Robert Koch Institute is anything to go by, wearables will be immensely valuable if a similar pandemic was to strike again in the future. They found that based on an uptick in resting heart rate alone, 4 days before people felt any symptoms, that metric alone could be used to diagnose up to 63% of COVID cases. So look, we're not talking about a massive body of research, but there does seem to be some signs that this whole notion of the quantified self holds promise in terms of future healthcare. So to borrow the words of Wolf again, we live in a world of numbers. So how else are we to understand ourselves? And this is reflected in the available data for all wearable device users. So when we look at the results of that survey I mentioned before of over 1,000 wearable device users, which is the only data that I'm aware of that delves into the specifics of why people use their trackers, we found that people almost every single day check things like their heart rate, their resting heart rate, their sleep, the number of calories they're burning, the distance they travel. But the single most checked metric, anyone want to guess? Step count. When I think about measurement in today's society, how it's used and misused and how we internalize its logic, I often end up thinking about a single figure, 10,000 steps. It's a figure that we've come accustomed to because it's often cited as an ideal target in lots of apps and gadgets and programs. The logic being that if you cross this magic threshold of 10,000 steps, that you'll be happier and healthier as a result. It's quoted with such authority and ubiquity that you'd think that it was the result of scientific inquiry. But the reality is that it originated in a marketing campaign by a Japanese company called Yamasa Clock in 1965. They had developed this new digital pedometer, which they ended up calling the 10,000 step meter. And the reason they selected this name, Manpo K, is because the kanji for 10,000 looks like a figure striding forward with confidence. There was no science to justify that 10,000 steps. It's just a visual pun. And in a global sense, you could argue that it's wrong. We now know that 10,000 steps is is too many for older adults and sometimes puts them off exercise, and it's too few for young kids. But I think this kind of misses the point, because 10,000 is a generic, memorable, and achievable target for a very large proportion of the population. Any increased activity is good for us, and people who do pursue a target of 10,000 steps have fewer signs of depression, stress, and anxiety, regardless of whether they actually reach that target or not. So, in a sense, Wolf and the Quantified Self movement seem to have a point. If you want to reach people, you need to speak in a language that they understand. So, because of the unwarranted prestige we give numbers, because of their appealing simplicity, and because they are trusted, that figure of 10,000 has stood the test of time. And I think for the better. The question the Quantified Self movement is still grappling with, though, is whether wearables can accurately measure what they say they are measuring. Because when we take a step back from those individual examples and those individual studies and look at our systems of quantification as a whole, the underbelly of the beast is revealed a little bit. So this is something that we recently looked into. We conducted an umbrella review, a systematic review of systematic reviews, looking at all of the research into consumer wearable devices and whether they can accurately measure what they say they are measuring. This is a massive body of research, and I can't get into the details, and I just don't have the time. Essentially, in over 400 studies, overall, the news was good. Four specific metrics. Accepting a little bit of error, wearables can measure your heart rate, particularly at low and moderate intensities, your heart rate variability, your aerobic capacity, which is a really strong predictor of your overall mortality risk, your blood oxygen saturation, and yes, the number of steps you take every day. Not very well, but quite well. They're not so good at measuring your energy expenditure. They both underestimate and overestimate that. Nor are they great at measuring your sleep. But the commercial ecosystem continues to evolve, with new software updates and hardware being released, usually on a yearly cycle. The challenge that comes for those of us in the wearable device community is that every time there's a new device or a new proprietary algorithm, all that old validity data essentially goes out the window, and we have to do it again. In our review, for example, there wasn't a single device included in the primary research studies that either hadn't been discontinued or replaced by a new device, even though the primary research included in our review was from late 2022. So essentially, it was out of date. And because the academic engine is a slow and lumbering beast, keeping up with every new hardware release and new software release while going through that gauntlet of securing funding, getting ethical approval, recruiting participants, testing those participants, analyzing the data, writing up the results, and then publishing it, keeping up with the commercial ecosystem is pretty much impossible. In short, I think we need a new approach to this whole concept of validation and how we use wearable devices, because if we don't know what can be measured and what is worth measuring, the ultimate endpoint of the quantified self movement will never be achieved. Wearables will never be that healthcare panacea that they are touted as. Now, obviously, my viewpoint is cast by an Irish context, but I don't think that we're alone in some of the challenges that we'll face in the near future. An aging population, an overburdened healthcare system, and increasing sedentariness. Many see wearables as a way to solve all of these problems, or at least part of it, a way to remotely monitor population health, a way to initiate national public health initiatives, a way to limit the spread of disease or predict outbreaks. The first step, from my point of view, is we need a way to centralize the wearable device data, a central sort of platform, a hub for it, because right now, whether you own an Apple or a Fitbit or a Garmin, you're essentially tethered to that individual manufacturer's app ecosystem. There's no way to migrate your data between ecosystems. There's no way to share your data with a healthcare provider or a researcher in public health. And you cannot easily take your data yourself and analyze trends over the years. Think about it like this. If you continue to wear the device you're wearing now for the next 10, 20, or 30 years, what insights might you glean? What might you uncover that might save your life, be it a gradually deteriorating aerobic capacity, or an increasing blood pressure, or a new cardiac arrhythmia? What might we learn at a population level? So this is the premise of some of the work that my research group is currently conducting to set up a data bank and a data donation platform for wearable devices, something that researchers can leverage to conduct studies into public health, for instance, to look at why people stop or restart physical activity, and also something that can be used in clinical trials involving wearables. We also see this as a way for end users to untether themselves from wearable devices. Because there is a possible dystopian future in this whole wearable quantified self ecosystem, where the data that is being captured could be used against people, particularly when it is the user themselves who is not in control of it. Already, some of the most tracked individuals on Earth suffer hugely from it. In the US, Amazon warehouse workers, every minute of every day of their working day is quantified so that Amazon can squeeze more labor out of them. But for many, the most extreme example of this dynamic can be seen in China, which has a social credit system which is used to shape individual behavior. It's pretty amorphous at the moment, but it's been in place in regional trials since 2009. Basically, the system records all kinds of behavior and categorizes it as either good or bad. Now, the focus is generally on social responsibility. You can be marked down for cheating in video games or not paying your bills on time, or not cleaning up after your dog. And you can be rewarded for things like donating to charity or giving blood. If you've got a good social credit score, you might be given cheaper access to bike and car sharing schemes or free health checkups. And if you have a poor social credit score, your travel might be restricted. For example, in 2019, the National Development and Reform Commission in China denied 17.5 million flights and 5.5 million rail journeys to those deemed untrustworthy by the social credit system. Now, this might seem a little scary to those of us in the global West, but the program had high approval ratings in older, wealthier, better educated citizens because it seemed to foster a sense of trust in a country shaken by the destruction of traditional social structures. And is it so different to the surveillance capitalism that's going on here in Europe, where Amazon, Meta, Google, and TikTok are all monitoring your online search behaviors to endlessly try and predict your patterns of insurance purchase, retail, and finance, just so that they can sell you an ever-widening range of goods and services? They might say, what's so bad about an insurance company knowing about or using a fitness tracker to incentivize physical activity in a group, so that it can lower their premium, or making them wear a fitness tracker and encouraging them to hit a number of steps each week? Because there is a sort of a dystopian endpoint which I can really only touch briefly upon. In my view, wearables will get more and more accurate. They will be better and more capable of measuring lots of aspects of your health. This could be used as a force for good. It could be used, for instance, to identify those who, because of their behaviors or biometric profiles now, are at an increased risk of cardiovascular, metabolic, or neurological disease 10, 20, or 30 years down the line. You know, maybe this could be used to initiate a program of prophylaxis where you're contacted by your healthcare provider and put on some kind of prevention program to mitigate the risk of disease. We're at an inflection point, I think, and it will be important to have this kind of dialogue so that whatever reality comes to pass, it's the one that we choose rather than it being the one that's forced upon us. So thank you for your time, and I welcome any questions. Thanks.